This newborn Earth, on its 1,000th birthday, somewhat resembles present-day Venus. It is, in many ways, an almost identical, turbulent, troubled, hot world. To survive in such harsh conditions, we would have to turn to ideas of colonization designed for our sister planet. For example, living in aerostat cities floating in the air far away from the surface. In fact, these would be mega dirigibles, capable of floating in the dense Venusian atmosphere. Or, as in our case, in the atmosphere of the young Earth. Approximately half of the surface of the freshly baked planet is melted oceans of magma, and the rest is more or less solid frozen lava crust. However, even this surface is quite unstable. Meteorite falls easily penetrate the crust, creating many lava seas and lakes kilometers across. However, these little space pebbles do not fall very often. Interestingly, most of them do not come from the depths of interplanetary space, but from near-Earth space. At this time, a whole swarm of debris revolves around our planet. This is the result of the collision of the Earth and Theia, thanks to which our moon was formed. There are so many cosmic stones and so much floating debris that our planet resembles the present Saturn. It has two rings. The first is between the Earth and the moon, and the second is behind the moon. The real bombardment won't begin anytime soon for the young Earth. Only after approximately 300 million years will something mysterious occur in the far part of the solar system, causing the gas giants to begin to make changes in their orbits, creating a complete gravitational mess around the local asteroids and comets, and thus throwing many of them into the inner part of the solar system, directly at Mars, Earth, Venus, and Mercury. It is at that point that most of the craters will be formed, which we can now see on the moon and the inner planets. We now call this period the Late Heavy Bombardment. By the way, the moon for the newborn Earth is huge and incredibly bright. After its formation, it was 6.5 times closer to Earth than it is now. Its surface is entirely melted lava. There is not a single solid rock island. Our satellite at this point shines on the new Earth like a huge lantern, and its gravity affects our planet 25 times stronger. The baby Earth performs one revolution around its axis, not in 24 hours, but in just 6. As a result, lava tides are 25 times stronger than our current sea tides, and are repeated every 3 hours. The moon literally drives the lava across the surface of the Earth. The giant moon is not the only feature in the sky of the young Earth. No one will recognize this early starscape. Remember that stars move slowly across the sky over time. Most of our visible stars now did not exist 4 billion years ago. For the early Earth, 2 very bright stars seem to shine in the sky, but they are actually planets, Jupiter and Saturn. The inner rocky planets are made of stone and cannot remain fully molten for very long. Jupiter and Saturn, on the other hand, consist of gas, which heats up much more easily and retains its temperature much longer due to the hot cores of the gas giant planets and their incredible mass. By the end of the formation of the Earth, Jupiter was at a temperature of 5,000 degrees and Saturn at 3,000. This means that, in fact, they were not technically gas giants, but giant plasma planets, and Jupiter almost equaled the faintest stars in its luminosity. Even the Sun was not as it is now. It's known that our star is impermanent, and every year it shines brighter and brighter. 4.5 billion years ago, it was 30% dimmer. The high temperature on the newborn Earth is reinforced by greenhouse gases. In fact, almost the entire Earth's atmosphere consists of just one gas with an incredibly powerful greenhouse effect, methane. Try to breathe it, and death will come in less than a minute. Over the next 2 billion years, life will spread across the oceans and the atmosphere will fill with oxygen, which will react with the methane, creating carbon dioxide and water. The greenhouse effect of the carbon dioxide will not be enough to maintain the heat, and the methane will be reduced to too small of an amount to have much of an effect. The Earth will grow cold, and the longest glacial period in Earth's history will come, the Huronian glaciations. The planet will become completely covered in ice. And it will stay this way for 300 million years, until, at last, the warming sun melts the ice. There is astonishing tectonic activity on the newborn Earth. The mantle is at a temperature of almost 3,000 degrees. The continents don't move like the modern versions, at a mere few millimeters per year. Their average speed is tens of meters per year. Giant mountains can grow over just decades. Volcanic eruptions cover the surface with lava for thousands of kilometers in every direction and throw millions of tons of toxic gases into the atmosphere. Earthquakes generate lava tsunamis that circle the Earth several times over. Water tsunamis will not appear on the planet for quite some time, as on the red-hot surface of this young planet, liquid water instantly evaporates. And it will remain hot for a long, long time due to the greenhouse gases not letting it cool. Only 300 million years after the late heavy bombardment will ice comets finally bring water to the surface. The young Earth is completely different from our present-day old Earth, with its quiet seas and oceans, and its calm space companion, the Moon. If an unprepared man were to appear on its surface, he would not survive for even one painful minute. Only a carefully trained group of people with perfected technology and vast knowledge could live on the early Earth for even a few days, and even that is not a sure thing.